We'll let these last people walk out.
Welcome to BuzzFeed Presents, The Secrets to Social. Thank you all for coming. We're really excited to share what we know with you guys.
Thank you for the applause.
My name is Ella. I'm an executive producer for BuzzFeed Entertainment Group. I've been with BuzzFeed for a little over 4 years, maybe four and a half now. I started when we were a pretty small video division, only about four or five video producers in a small office in Culver City. I've helped launch many of our channels and brands, BuzzFeed Violet, our Snapchat channel, and right now I'm working in development, helping develop new properties and shows. I'm currently working on some 360 content.
Hi, I'm Macy Thornton. I'm the director of social media for BuzzFeed Entertainment Group. And I started a couple months after Ella, so I've been at BuzzFeed for about 4 years. And my team is responsible for publishing all of our video content across all of the platforms that BuzzFeed is on.
I'm Rico Moore. I'm a business analyst on the learning tools team, so we build all the cool tools that let the company know all of the data that's happening, all that fun stuff. Before that, I was chief of staff to Zay, who's our president of entertainment, and I've been at the company about 9 months now.
New but old. 9 months is a long time in BuzzFeed time.
So today what we're gonna talk about is how BuzzFeed thinks about cracking new platforms and formats. We're also gonna talk a little bit about YouTube and how we got to where we are today on YouTube, same with Facebook. And then we're gonna talk about how we do this at such a large scale. And at the end, there's gonna be an opportunity for some questions.
Cool, so to kind of frame the rest of the stories we're gonna tell, this is what BuzzFeed's kind of growth curve looks like anytime we try to crack a new platform or launch a new initiative. So it's pretty much standard startup growth curve. We have a small team that's just looking for some kind of signal, and for us, signal is a certain number of shares, views, whatever it is. Basically information that the audience likes what we're doing. Once we find it, we do more of it. And then once that keeps working and we kind of honed in on it, we throw a bunch of people at it. And we have a saying, don't fuck with growth. So, you know, once it's growing, we just like let it go. Finally, it'll hit a point to where it becomes a little unwieldy, and that's when we add a lot of process and tech to make it very, very efficient. And finally, from there, it's pretty much a mature business, and it goes from there.
Cool. So this is what BuzzFeed looked like in 2006. At the time, we were just a website, and we were really just a collection of all of your favorite things from the internet, trending content, cat gifs, everything that you would really want to find on the internet. BuzzFeed was the hub of that. When Zay Frank joined in 2012, he launched our video department, and that's when we realized pretty early on that video wasn't quite working on our owned and operated platform. It felt like it was more native and natural to YouTube. So we launched our YouTube channel and started focusing primarily on YouTube.
And once we figured out that we didn't just have to live on on the website, and we could also make content that was very, very successful on other platforms, we doubled down on it. So this is our overall footprint now. We spend a whole lot of platforms and a whole lot of accounts on each platform, and we make very bespoke content for each.
So back in 2013, 2014, we were, as I mentioned before, we were a really small team, 4 to 6 and growing a little bit every month producers. And each producer made 2 videos a week, and it was something that we really relied on to support our channel. It was very intense. We would stay up late trying to finish our videos and post them at that time. But what we realized was being able to create so much content allowed us to learn more. So the more content we published, the more we learned, and we really focused on creating a bunch of content. So today, we publish 600 pieces of content every day, and we have 3.5 million content pieces to date, which is incredible. And this is where we are now. It's really crazy to see these numbers for me, because I remember as we were trying to crack new benchmarks, our first 1 million subscribers, our first 25 million view month, I never would have thought that those weirdos in a room just making videos would amount to this success, and I'm really proud of it. A lot of people ask me how we come up with our ideas. So basically, we like to think of the internet as a large conversation, an ongoing conversation, a hub of different things. There's smaller conversations happening in specific identity groups and little places, but overall there's a larger cultural context that's always going on. And we like to think, how can we add to it and how can we further it? So it's not like we're trying to encompass everything that's going on in every video, but we try to find things that interest us and further it along. We also are split up into specific content teams. So we have teams from 4 to 8 people focused on specific content types, and they have shared goals. They give each other notes on their videos, maybe they help out with shoots, they also brainstorm together. But the really important thing that I think differentiates us from a lot of companies is that the individual producer is responsible for their video from the inception of the video idea all the way until it's published. So they are the creator of it, they write it, they direct it, they shoot it, they cast it, they get the locations, they edit it. And sometimes they're even in the video themselves. So we like to think of our producers as multi-hyphenates. They have a lot of support and infrastructure that we've provided them, but they're the creative mind behind the videos. Whenever we go into cracking a new format or platform, of course you have to figure out what your goal is. We have many teams that are focused on a lot of different goals, whether it's, you know, a certain specific audience group. So we have a team called Paralike who's focused on Latino content. We also have teams that are focused on gaming content, beauty content. But our overall metrics are pretty broad. For Facebook, we focus on shares, and for YouTube, we focus on views. For some scripted content, we're looking now at watch time retention, but these are our basic metrics that we kind of base all of our goals around. So back when I started making video for BuzzFeed in around 2013, we really looked to BuzzFeed.com for inspiration, since it was kind of the hub of trending content, relatable content. And we used that to guide us, to help us make content decisions. So during that time, we saw that there was a lot of buzz around like secret menu stuff, and we asked ourselves, how would this look as a video? It was kind of a list post of different items, but it did so well that we wanted to figure out how we would translate that to a video form. So that video, cool. So yeah, this was the list post, and we wanted to see how this would look as a video. So this was the first taste test that we did. I actually made this video on like a random Friday afternoon when I was trying to figure out this problem. It was actually the first time that we had, you know, done this type of video, like tasted food on camera. And that's not to say that we invented tasting food on camera or the taste test in general. We definitely did not. But we, I think, helped popularize it, and it became one of our core formats, and we based many, many brands and formats on this. So once we realized that the try format itself did really well, that more, like, the try guys came after that, Lady Light, Paralike, most of our brands. And another funny thing about this is, we, in our early videos, really didn't have people talking that much. And that was because we actually didn't really have enough sound equipment. So once we started to invest in that a little bit further, we're like, yeah, this YouTube thing really is taking off. We started to innovate with our formats more. But this really is a core format of ours, and we've expanded out with many, many of our brands from this format.
Awesome. So at this kind of stage in BuzzFeed's history, YouTube's humming along, and we're starting to kind of get an itch, like, what's the next thing going to be? And at the time, in late 2013, you could publish video on Facebook, but publishers and news sites weren't really focusing on that. They were focusing on their owned and operated, and on some people were on YouTube. And so we decided, okay, we don't know if video is really going to be a thing on Facebook, but why don't we just start putting our YouTube content onto Facebook really passively, and we can just kind of watch what's happening in the background. And we were also looking at what other people outside of BuzzFeed were doing on Facebook for video. And again, like, publishers weren't really there, so we had to look at what real people were doing. And what real people were doing was kind of sharing information, sharing parts of their days. I don't know if any of you remember this video, but it went really viral on Facebook in 2013. And it's just this awesome guy showing how to cut a watermelon in this really crazy, unique way. And the video got over 1 million shares on Facebook. And at the time, we hadn't seen something like that before with video on Facebook, so that kind of gave us this early signal, oh wow, you really can make a huge splash on Facebook. So from there, again, we were still really passively.
Oh, they were watching him do
it. Oh, sorry. I can't see that on the screen.
He dumps it out and they're all cubed.
That's the most exciting part. I'm sorry, guys.
Watermelons are always viral.
Yes, that's one very important takeaway from this presentation. But so in August of 2014, we started seeing some of our own massive hits on Facebook with content that we had kind of just been passively putting on there. One of them turned into a whole series that we call Weird Couples. The first one was Weird Things All Couples Fight About. It now has over 2 million shares on Facebook, and it's still one of our most successful pieces of content ever. And that, again, gave us this signal, like, wow, not only can other people do this, like, we're starting to kind of figure this out. So a couple months after that, Zay Frank, who's the president of BuzzFeed Entertainment Group, sent me an email and said, okay, Macy, if you were to think of Facebook pages as channels, what would you do? And now that sounds pretty obvious, but at the time it was kind of like a revolutionary way to think about Facebook. At the time we only had BuzzFeed Video and BuzzFeed as Facebook pages, and so I was like, I think what I would do is focus on relationship and identity content, because that's what we had kind of been seeing work, and I would call it Story of My Life. And he was like, okay, tomorrow, make that happen. And so I did, and so we launched the first Facebook page that BuzzFeed ever had that wasn't branded as BuzzFeed. We kind of wanted to see what would happen if we weren't standing on the back of the BuzzFeed brand that we had already built up pretty big at this point. So we made this page, and what we were really going for was having a super discreet audience that was, if you went to the page, you would look at the artwork, you would look at the name, you'd look at the way we were programming the page, and you would know, this is exactly what I'm gonna get, and that's why I'm gonna like this page. And again, since this was like our first foray into this, we did not know what success looked like here. So at the time, we actually thought this was really successful. It got around 200,000 page likes in the first 2 months, and a lot of the content was also doing really well. A lot of videos would get over 100,000 shares. So we're like, okay, we're Facebook, like, we want to invest in this thing. So we did what BuzzFeed tends to do in those situations, and we put like a really focused team of talented people on Facebook. So they had to have a name, so their name was FB40, and their goal was really to make videos that would get over 1 million shares on Facebook. So to do that, they just threw a bunch of stuff at the wall to try and see what would stick. So they made tons of different content. And again, it was just like, let's optimize this for Facebook, let's get 1 million shares. So they were trying lots of different content categories, lots of different formats. And then you might have guessed that the thing that stuck for them was food. So this video that they made in early 2015, what got around 70,000 shares on Facebook. And as you can see, it's 16:9. We don't have the audio playing, but it is kind of audio dependent. They're explaining what they're doing. There's people in the video. So we were like, okay, 70,000 shares, you know, it's not 1 million, but it's also pretty good. We think we're on the right track, so how can we test and learn, and where can we go from here? So then the team rented an Airbnb and shot a ton of videos in sort of a similar format, but the things they changed were they made the videos square, they made them totally not audio dependent, they took people out of them, and they did this, like, we call them like the floating hands, but it's really a way that you can kind of see yourself making the videos. They also had this hunch that videos that looked like kind of more user generated and not as nice would do better, so they shot everything on phones. And those two videos did even better than the first Instagram video. One of them got over 200,000 shares. And this beautiful chili bread dip
original recipe.
And it got over 500,000 shares. So we're like, whoa, this is happening. Like, we're really figuring it out. So we just completely leaned into this idea of short form content that was top down, that was really optimized for autoplay. So the first 3 seconds, you want to get something out of it. And from that, Tasty was born. So again, at the time that we launched Tasty, our biggest success was this SOML page. So we didn't really know at the time still what success exactly was. But Tasty gave us a good idea of that. And we got over 1 million likes on Facebook in the first month. And now there's 7 international editions. The page has over 86 million fans on Facebook, and it's the biggest publisher on Facebook. So even though that's, like, you know, it's pretty crazy that Tasty is so ginormous now, I think it's really important to remember that it wasn't created by chefs or food experts. It was created by people who totally love food, but their end goal was really just connecting with people and thinking about social first. And just like we iterate off of videos and we're always testing and learning with video content, we really do the same thing with all of our processes. So after the success of Tasty, we're like, okay, we want to do this again and again and again. So we did the exact same thing to launch all of these other brands that we have. We would, you know, get signal that some type of content area is working, and then we would put a team of people on it, have them make a ton of stuff, and if we saw that big spike that this is working, we blow it up and we create something out of it.
All right. So a big part of, you know, being able to scale all of this process is using technology to support the business. So, you know, as we've gone through over the last few examples, with the O&L, you know, we basically did this. With YouTube, we had a small team that Ella was on. They were working, they were trying things out. I think it's important to keep in mind that at the time, the producers who were working on YouTube were also the ones who were posting the videos to YouTube as well.
Yeah.
So if you look at kind of like the simplest case scenario, you know, we're at VidCon, so we got a lot of creators here, right? If you're a creator, you're the one making the content, you're the one posting it, you're the one optimizing it, you're the one looking at the comments and kind of building the relationship with the fans, and those are the elements of your feedback loop, right? You hear what the fans want, you incorporate that back into production. With Facebook, we had a small team that was making the stuff, and then we had Macy and her team who were actually like posting the content, but it was, you know, small team, someone posting to a specific page, and then everyone can watch that page to see when their video went up, how it did, and then they could take that and keep on iterating. And that's our feedback loop, right? So we have the site, we have apps, we have other apps, all this other fun stuff. But effectively, it's you have people making things, you have people publishing things, and they go somewhere. The audience says something about it, and then ideally that brings it back to the people who are making it, and you can go on and on. Now, the hard part is, when you want to do that at scale, right? And earlier we were talking about how the more chances you take, the more information that you get, and the more you can kind of like learn and figure things out. When you have, you know, a whole lot of producers trying to make all this content that's going to end up on a whole lot of different pages, the producers, it's hard to get the information back to them because they're working on their own videos. They don't have time to check 100 accounts to see which account their video went up on. So we ran into this problem, right? Effectively, it's like, our raw data lives in a whole lot of places. So you put up a video on Facebook, let's say that gets shared across a bunch of different accounts. It's hard to know what accounts they got shared to, et cetera. We had producers who wanted to know, how did this video do? How did these 10 videos do that were similar to this video that I'm making now? And it was hard because we had a small research team and all of these requests would go to them. But everybody needs access to that information all the time. And so we have like a couple of options, right? One option is, okay, we're gonna stop empowering our creators and instead we're gonna say, okay, there's a few people who know what's going on and we're gonna let them tell everybody else what to make and that's just how it's gonna go. We're gonna go to the typical publisher model. And the other option was we're gonna give everybody access to this data, we're gonna figure out how to do it. And then from there, people will be empowered to make their own decisions and we can, you know, have more of those sparks of innovation. So here's the problem, right? A lot of creators, a lot of content, a lot of accounts across a lot of platforms. And one of BuzzFeed's core tenets is that, you know, we're kind of a full stack startup. So ever since the beginning, we've invested a lot in our technology infrastructure. We have a huge engineering team and we put those guys on figuring out how do we give all this data to everybody in the company. And we ended up building a whole lot of tools as a result of that. So this list up here is not comprehensive. We actually have like more than this. But here's like a nice little subsection of all the things that we've built. So we have tools that handle everything from pre-production to production to post-production to when things actually go out. If any creator anywhere in the world, and we have offices here, New York, Austin, Brazil, Japan, London, all these places. All these creators over there have access to all of the learnings that any creator is finding, right? So if someone makes a video in Brazil, we can know about it here, and we've got really good kind of metadata tagging and things like that. So it's easy to find content that's similar to yours, and you can kind of get inspiration and things like that. It also is really good for our advertising business because our sales team and all those folks can find content that fits specific brand objectives and things like that. But there's a lot of internal information that lives in the system as well as a lot of performance data that lives in the system. And you know, our theory is it'd be pretty much impossible to create and innovate at the scale that we do if we didn't have a unified tech infrastructure. And we're still learning, right? We're still making new tools, and we're still driving insights out of those tools.
Part of the importance of having that tech infrastructure, as Rico said, is when it comes down to the individual producer and what you do with that data as an individual producer. So being able to see what videos have done well previously and the styles or formats that you're interested in. So one really specific example of that is our show Worth It. One of our producers, Steven, was able to look at all of our formats that have done really well and kind of combine them into this format. And he wouldn't have been able to do that without all of that previous knowledge. So Worth It Now is the number one show on YouTube. It averages around 11 million views per episode, and it set a record for us in the most minutes watched in a day. But that, even like cracking this specific format, isn't just the end for us. We love to iterate based on our successes and continue that feedback loop with data. So we've expanded this show to lifestyle and beauty. But in general, we like to think of it as like, if we crack something, it always leading to something new. So platforms are always changing, audiences are always changing. And being able to have that knowledge to constantly tweak what we're doing is really, really important. Just because we made a format that worked for us in 2013 doesn't mean that's working for us now in 2017.
So the main takeaways that we're hoping you take away from today are to cater original content to individual platforms. People are going to different platforms for different things, and you want to give them those. So, like I was saying before, maybe if you're just starting on an emerging platform, you can kind of be more passive on it, but once you've cracked it, you really want to make content that's special for that platform. Another one is to prioritize a specific metric for each platform and optimize for it. For BuzzFeed, it's really worked to rally people around a really specific shared goal.
And as far as building a tight feedback loop and democratizing your data, so this again is very much like a scale thing, but it's really, really important that the people making the content are able to get as much information about how the audience responded to it as possible. And likewise, it's really important for everyone in the organization to know what's going on and be able to see that easily. You know, I think people use the word data a lot, but really it's just information, right? Like, you need information about how the audience is reacting to something. You need information about what's getting made, what worked, what didn't work. And democratizing your data allows you to do that. But it's not all about numbers. It's also about kind of the way that you present it to people.
Yeah, and the last thing is really learning from your audience and trying to give them what they want. The word clickbait is often thrown around with what we do, but we don't like to think of it as clickbait. If you're delivering the audience what they expected to get, you're not tricking them. It might be a very clickable title, it might be trending, it might be popular, but if you're not lying to the audience about what the content is and they're satisfied with it, that's not clickbait. So we are always trying to optimize for the audience, and we really, really want to give them what they want. And you know, I think it's important, like when you're reading news headlines or news articles, you see that the headline of the article and it says something very specific, and you still click on it, it's maybe an expanded version of what that headline is. There's something really, really satisfying about clicking on something and it fully delivering on that.
Totally. And so, you know, we want to wrap up to say, you know, we want to optimize for human connections and not algorithms. What I mean by that is, you know, I know that there's a lot of talks about how to hack the Facebook algorithm and how to hack the YouTube algorithm and all that fun stuff, right? Well, a lot of those are driven by like neural nets, and the people who actually make them don't know how they work. But moreover, I think, you know, if you've been at VidCon for the last few years, you know that when they change the algorithm, if you built your whole business and your whole strategy around it, then like you tank, and it's not good, right? I think the thing that I like the most about BuzzFeed is from the beginning, yes, we worry about, you know, how do we maximize the reach of this particular piece of content, but we start with how do we make content that connects with people, right? And I think if you make good content, if you make content that connects with people, if you make content with the audience in mind first, then the rest of those follow. And you know, you're kind of future-proofed as new platforms and new changes in the algorithms come up. So with that, we've got a good amount of time for questions.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. Thanks. Woo!
Yeah, do we have a mic?
Is there a mic for questions? Okay, I think it's coming.
Y'all want one?
Yeah, I guess
we
can just start.
Okay.
I'll repeat that.
Yeah. Can you guys speak to two questions? One, to the division of labor, you know, in this kind of a production process between people filming, creating stuff, mm-hmm. and whatever the various teams are you have, prepping that, you know, mm-hmm. to the final upload and then review.
So the question, if you guys couldn't hear it, was if we could speak to the division of labor between the people making the content, the people actually, like, you know, optimizing it for social and distributing.
Yeah. I would say, so for a very, very long time, we were very creator heavy. So most people were producers who took on much of the publishing and social roles in those early years. But now we've kind of built out a huge production studio. So we have a huge campus in Hollywood where we have equipment distribution, production support, a casting department, an art department. So now I would say the support outweighs the amount of producers. I'm not sure on the specific numbers, but we have those fully developed departments.
And then in terms of the publishing of the content, my team doesn't like live inside this vacuum. We work really, really closely with the content creators. Most people on my team are embedded with a content team. So we have two people embedded with Tasty, people embedded in Peril, like really every different group, and their job is to really help with this feedback loop. So they kind of sit in between Rico's team, like the data team, and the content creators, and they're kind of trying to give the info back and forth.
And we have internal tools that kind of like manage that whole process end to end.
What is your employee turnover rate? Do people stay there a long time, or do they
We have a pretty low turnover rate in video specifically. I can't speak to the larger company, but in video specifically, it's been...
We don't know like exactly.
I don't know the exact numbers, but like off the top of my head, like anecdotally, I would say we only have people we rarely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, back there. Is there? Yeah.
Oh,
you're bringing the mic. Okay.
Okay, so the question I have is, in the early days you guys started, as you started your channels, you had to start different, you know, accounts basically for each sub-brand. Nowadays you see like YouTube and Facebook are starting to develop, you know, like almost the capability to keep all of those underneath one like overarching account. They've added new tools, you know, obviously you guys had already gone pretty far down the other road before they even developed that capability. If you were to start from today, would you still start completely separate brand accounts for each of these sub-brands, or would you kind of would you use some of the new tools that are evolving to group subgroup them? Does that make sense?
Yeah. So all of our different Facebook pages and YouTube channels are still under like one big umbrella under like Facebook CMS or YouTube CMS. But I think we would still probably go in this direction of making sub-brands or franchises or whatever word you want to use for them that are very separate. But we, you know, now that we have this global cross-platform network, we did in the past and continue to use the different pages and channels that we have to grow new ones that we start. So, you know, if we launch Bring Me, which is a destination travel page that we launched in February, we use Tasty to help make it into the success that it is. So it's easier now than it was when we did it at the beginning.
Yeah, and I think there's a certain amount of value to kind of having, you know, a little bit of separation just because we have a lot of different audiences. And I think for BuzzFeed specifically, we're very much catered towards like specific deep identities, right? So when we look at someone coming to BuzzFeed for like everything, I think there's something to landing on a page that speaks directly to you and other people like you without kind of like everybody else.
Yeah, because I think one of the things that's important is not, for the specific identity groups, not having it overlap so much with the general audience. Like I mentioned Parolike, our Latino content group before, and we want to specifically speak to, you know, millennial Latinos, and so it doesn't necessarily work to overlap with sharing on our bigger pages. So it might be harder initially to grow those, but we'll have a stronger, more invested audience if we just focus on creating that original content. Over there, in the middle.
Hi, I love what you guys said about democratizing the data. So wonder if I can ask you two questions about that. One is, for those of us who have in-house creative teams that are creating content but are not necessarily paying attention to the outcomes of those things, how did you approach getting your creatives to think about the end result? And then the second piece is, what advice could you give people to setting up those internal tools to facilitate that process?
Definitely. I guess you want to talk about like the button analytics?
Yeah. So we luckily have a very fun, intense work environment. So we have a lot of people who are obsessed with making video content, obsessed with the internet, and really live and breathe that whole world. So the performance of their videos is very important to them naturally as creators. But there's always things that you can do to make it more fun. So, you know, early on we started having prizes for different benchmarks being reached and really celebrating the people who reach certain benchmarks and making that like a clear and fun goal. So when you make it a little bit more fun than just looking at data and kind of making it this exciting end of week thing that we all gathered around to kind of applaud the people who hit certain benchmarks, I think it really made people more invested in looking at that data.
Totally. And from just like a tactical standpoint, right, you want some place that has the name of the person that made the video and then the actual video and then that video's performance. Right, so whether that is, you know, working with a vendor that kind of keeps track of where all these videos go, so maybe like a Tubular or something like that, and then also just keeping track somewhere of this person made this video and this is where it lives, right? Or these are the places that it lives. If you're able to kind of automate that system, then you can have a view for every person, and like Ella was talking about, right? Like the other part is once you make that data available, there needs to be at least in my opinion, a public setting and where it's discussed,
yeah.
Right? And then kind of like social rewards and motivations for that, right?
Yeah.
Like, because if you don't build a performance culture, then I think a lot of creatives' tendency is to make things that work for them,
yeah.
But not necessarily work for the audience.
We always stress that, like, it's important to not create work in a vacuum. You know, if you're the only one watching it and enjoying it, that's great if that's what you want to do. But to work in social video, we want to be a part of the community and make sure that there is that interaction. So it not just being about what you care about and like, but also being able to share it is really, really valuable.
Totally.
In the front?
How do you choose the data you collect?
How do you choose the data you collect? Do you go for the more numeric kind of thing, like likes, shares, or you go into semantics of comments?
Yeah.
And do you buy this information from someone, or do you have some cool tech to collect it?
Totally, yeah, this is one of my favorite questions. So,
just all the real hard things.
It's all the good stuff, yeah. But, you know, at companies I've been at before, it's definitely been a lot of kind of like high level data, right? The nice thing about BuzzFeed is, the core of our engineering team, a lot of those guys came like built Bitly, and so if you've ever used Bitly to like shorten your links, like on a technical level, it's like really really intense as far as like keeping track of all that stuff. So we basically built this thing that just sucks up everything. So whether it's like Facebook or YouTube or Pinterest or Twitter or whatever it is, we built this big just like vacuum cleaner that just takes everything in, and then from there we kind of decided what we want to surface, right? So. You'll hear kind of like the concept of a data lake. We built like a big data lake. And now we can kind of figure out, okay, what are the specific metrics that are useful to these specific people and kind of build business cases around there. And then we build really pretty UIs so that we can expose them to people. Because you don't want to give everybody everything because it's a fire hose,
yeah.
Right? You know, we want to be very targeted about like these are the things you need to know and put those in a very pretty way so that they're actionable.
And we make sure that producers go in with specific questions. So when they're making a video, we ask them to think of it as a test and to think about what they can learn from it. So we don't have these giant, typical, like, data questions. It's more like, is this thing going to work? What about it makes it work? And then producers themselves might want to surface data around comments or trying to get, you know, more of a barometer on how the audience is feeling about the content. So we might ask sometimes for a general comment feedback on certain pieces of content.
Yeah. And we've got some pretty cool things we're working on machine learning wise to like filter out like crap comments versus good comments. And then we're gonna implement all of that
those
as well.
Real good comments.
Those real, real good comments, yes.
With original testing. There we go. There you go. Okay. With original programming like YouTube Red originals that you're producing, do you hold them to the same standards that you just shared with everybody, or do you kind of view them differently given the smaller audience?
We view everything with the same standards, so it's very hard on all of us. But yes, we uphold all of our content to the same standards. We might look at different metrics, you know, for different types of content, particularly scripted content. We look a lot at watch time retention, which is something we might not look at on other pieces of content, really depending on what you're trying to accomplish with the video. We'll target it in a certain way.
Thank you.
Right there.
You did say that Create for Human Connections, not algorithms. However, has there ever been a time when you have been surprised by an algorithm change, either damaging the traction on your content or suddenly elevating the traction on your content?
Yeah, what was that like?
That's a great question. Do you know
anything? I mean, I definitely think with Facebook, when they kind of like turned the knob, as they might say, on video, we definitely felt that. We were really lucky that we had been kind of passively putting video content on the platform for several months before that, because it really gave us the upper hand versus other people that didn't even like get to see that knob turned up because they weren't putting video content there.
Yeah. Wasn't that time like, I don't remember how many, it was like sometime last year, YouTube changed something. And then we saw like some weird, anyway, yeah, it happens.
Sometimes, but because we have so many different content groups making different things at the same time, like certain things will pick up.
Yeah.
It's really hard for us to say if it's the algorithm or if it's something else or if it's audience behavior, since they're so linked. I think overall the biggest trend that we've seen in shifts are in like different times, different lengths of video feeling right at certain times. But I don't know if I would attribute that to an algorithm. I almost feel like it's just people's viewing habits changing and like feeling differently about content on different platforms. You know, like before I might not sit down and watch so much stuff on YouTube, I might browse it specifically, but now just as a consumer myself, I might go there to watch a show. And that's something that I might have not done a couple years ago.
And I think sometimes like we'll hear things or read articles and start to maybe get scared, like, oh, is this thing gonna happen and hurt us in some way? But so far, I think the reason that it hasn't happened is because we have this feedback loop. So if something changes in the algorithm, as long as we're continuing to focus on human connection and continuing to like iterate off the things that work, we'll continue in the right direction.
Yeah, hopefully.
this guy right behind me.
I have two quick questions. The first one, I believe it was last year, President Trump mentioned BuzzFeed, a horrible comment about BuzzFeed, so we have the social person here. What kind of decisions, or how did that play out to have the merchandise made, which I thought was an amazing
job. The failing,
job.
Garbage.
Yeah, so what,
for those of you who don't know.
What thoughts, how did that play out to kind of capitalize on that.
Right. You know, so that was aimed at the news department, which is completely separate from us, just to be very clear, or the entertainment group. And so we do have a line of church and state.
Yeah.
But as our like own policy, we like to poke fun at ourselves and we have a sense of humor about what we do. I think the people involved in that are really focused on like journalistic integrity. You know, we have a lot of amazing reporters and journalists who are putting in so much time and effort to provide like unbiased opinions. And I think it's a mix of that and a mix of being able to poke fun at yourself that like lends itself to that, these sort of products.
And we also donated, I think it was like $25,000, which was all the profit from the merchandise to the Society for Professional Journalists.
Yeah, so that one wasn't profit to us, but we know the people over doing our merchandise, and we didn't know exactly that it was going to happen, but when it did, we were like, yes, that feels really right. And I'm totally fine to be called that.
Proud feeling. Proud.
Yeah.
There's a massive community of entrepreneurs out there, and you recently released a partnership with Shopify. What are your thoughts around creating a channel to inspire more entrepreneurs?
That was dope.
Yeah.
I work at Shopify.
Yeah, I mean, we can't really speak to kind of like the overall strategy, I guess, but just like personally, I think the entrepreneurial identity is something that is very strong and there's a big audience for it. So it feels like something that would make sense.
Yeah.
Cool. It's
back here. Right, I think we got time for like two more.
Yeah. The other thing too, just before we start, is like the videos and the content idea, like the concepts themselves, it's not a top-down thing, it's like a bottom-up thing. So because all of the producers are like empowered with that data, they're the ones who are bringing forth like new opportunities, new styles, new genres. So it's not like we ever mandate down what content should be made. A producer does something really awesome and then we empower them and put more resources. So whenever like, it's only when like it's very clear, like let's do food on Facebook, this team. But for the most part, it's like empowering people. Yeah.
Cool, thanks very much for your time. My question is, can you talk a little bit about your localization strategy for video? I imagine like when you come across a really good piece of content, a really good concept, you want to spread it as far as you can. How do you prevent from, say, cannibalizing views on one channel with also serving the community on another channel if it's very similar or even the same video?
Yeah. I think it depends, right? So if you're looking international, those audiences aren't always the same. Right, so we have a pretty intense kind of like international adaptation and translation process that we've built out. Cannibalizing traffic kind of like across other pages, I guess like one thing is you could look at it in terms of how are you defining cannibalization, right? Like if that's like a views thing, if that's a shares thing, right? Like I think for us, we're always focused on just like building out the biggest audience, right? So kind of overall reach is something I think you can optimize by putting things in different places just so you've got as many points to hit. Usually it's probably something around, I think it just depends on how we define like cannibal.
If it's going to be reaching completely different audience groups, that's when we might think about posting in multiple places. I mean, I know you can speak to this more, but if it clearly is overlapping, it's not something we like to do. But if you're reaching specifically different types of people, then it seems like it would be not harmful.
Yeah.
And like I think when we early on we were kind of scared, you know, if we're putting all this stuff on YouTube, can we put the same thing on Facebook or will it cannibalize our YouTube views? And we really have not seen that. I think that there's just so many people watching content in so many different places.
Yeah.
That we just try and like get the content wherever we think the people are, and we don't seem to see like a big problem with cannibalism.
Yeah, the craziest thing was when we launched our Snapchat Discover channel, and I was in a Lyft pool situation, and people were like, oh, like I was like, where do you work? Oh, a lot of small talk, and they're like, oh, BuzzFeed from Snapchat. That I thought that was so strange, but it is really true. Audiences live in different places.
Right, like people that watch our content on Snapchat every day might not know that we exist somewhere else, which seems crazy to us.
We're like, wait, you just didn't Google it? Like,
they've given us the red light.
Oh.
So I think we got to call it a day, but thank you guys so much.
Thank you. Woo!